Hi, so this is my attempt at making a sort of a vlog type video, so I'm not building anything in this video, so if that's not your thing, just kind of go away. First thing I want to talk about is sponsorships, as in getting sponsorship from stuff like Audible.com or those mattress people. And I have certainly been approached by those, and I just have not been able to do one because inevitably, it involves me having to say things that I don't fully agree with, like get your free audiobook, when really you have to sign up for a plan and give them your payment information, and then remember to actually cancel, which in my books does not count as free. It's more of a trying to trick you into subscribing. And I'm just not willing to say these things when I don't agree with them, which is why I haven't been able to do a sponsorship. Sponsored by Audible.com or the mattress people or whatever. That's not to say that there won't be any sort of sponsored videos in the future. It's just I'm extremely selective about this sort of thing, and so far there hasn't been something that I've really agreed with. If it was about something that I really liked, for example, this Ryobi drill, I really like this. It's of the cheap corded drills, this is the best one that you can buy, because it's the only one that's got a two-stage gear reduction, which means gives you a hell of a lot more torque and more control than the other drills. But Ryobi's not paying me to say this, and I just said it for free, so there goes that sponsorship opportunity. But somebody did email me saying, hey, how about trading some lumber for exposure? And I initially said no, but it was about this Osag orange wood, this stuff here. And then I was kind of like, well, maybe I could mention it if you send me just a small amount because I don't want it to be too committed. That was months ago, and I'm feeling really guilty because I have not done anything with this wood. So the guy who sells this, he sells it online. He is Jake9282 at windscreen.net. So if you want to buy some of this wood, you can online. What's special about this wood is it grows around Texas, southern United States. And it's super heavy, super hard. It's pretty much like an exotic wood, except it grows in the United States. And for the most part, it's kind of a weed. So I figured I could use that where I use exotic wood. Thing is, I don't use a lot of exotic wood. Main places I've used exotic wood is, for instance, runners, like on the bottom of a sled, because I want that to be very durable, because of course, it always rubs against the table and it needs to not wear out. The other place I use exotic wood from time to time is bandsaw blade, guys. So, too lazy to move the camera, I just took the blade guides off the bandsaw. The guide blocks that guide the blade, because again, those need to be very hard and not easily wear out. The way I do hardness testing is to drop this particular screwdriver from a height of 6 feet, or about 1.8 meters, and I put a little thing on the end so I can hold it and then drop it. So, and then I measure how deep a divot it makes. So here's from some previous tests. So let me show you how I do that. So I put the wood on the ground, and then this is 1.8 meters up, and I have to be very careful how I drop the screwdriver so it doesn't twist or anything. And there's a little divot, and I'll repeat that a few times. And then I just measure the depth of my divots with a digital caliper. So for instance, this divot here measured 28 thou. This one, 28. And this one is at 21. So the divots in this one are much shallower than, for instance, this piece of white oak, where I've got 78, 84, and 71 thou. So the screwdriver punched much deeper in that one. But other woods that are surprisingly hard is bamboo, or maybe it's just resilient and then it bounces back. So I've got 28 thou, 30 thou, and 37 thou. So that's kind of comparable. Here's a piece of mahogany, and I got 28, 33, and 32 thou. And one of my favorite domestic hardwoods, as long as they're not extinct yet, is white ash. I dropped it on here a few times, 16 thou, 15 thou, and 35 thou. It varies a bit depending on whether you hit the hard or the soft part of the growth rings, but ash is one of the really hard domestic woods. I've got a whole article and table of divot depths versus wood types on my website, so if you want to compare your wood, it's easy enough. Just take a screwdriver of the right weight and drop it from 1.8 meters and compare to my numbers. These days, whenever I need a small piece of plywood, I usually just cut out of the corner of a bigger piece, and the reason for that is to save some. Normally, if you've got a bigger piece of plywood and you need a piece like this, the thing to do is to just make a cut like this, and make a cut like this, and there's your piece of plywood, and then you put the other two pieces aside to save for later, because you never know when you're going to need them. But what if the next piece of plywood that I needed was more this shape? So then I should have actually cut it off like this. But I don't know that ahead of time, so what I started doing is to just cut it out of the corner, and sometimes I have to recut it on the table saw afterwards, because I'll have to do that on a bandsaw. And this has two advantages. First of all, I don't have to decide what kind of piece I'm going to need next. And second, instead of having two pieces, I have one piece, which makes it much easier to keep track of what pieces of plywood I still have, so that if I need another scrap of the right kind, it's all still in one piece and contiguous and easier to find. And just to give people something to get worked up about, pocket holes. As you know, I don't like pocket holes, and I was thinking, what is sort of the opposite of pocket holes? And here's my conclusion. The opposite of pocket holes is a jointer. It might make more sense to say mortise and tenons are the opposite of pocket holes, but a lot of times you don't even need mortise and tenons. But what I've noticed is, in terms of watching YouTube videos, there are people who use pocket holes and there are people who use jointers. That's not to say that you can only use one or the other, but generally, woodworkers who rely on their jointer a lot don't use pocket holes, and woodworkers who use pocket holes generally don't even have a jointer. I think it's because using a jointer is all about just starting with the raw lumber and getting things super straight and precise, whereas pocket holes are all about using plywood and putting things together really quickly. And I do have to say, people who use pocket holes actually get stuff done a lot more quickly. It's just, I don't think it looks as nice, and I don't think it's as strong. Well, and there's just one more thing. A lot of you have been wondering, where's Rachel? You haven't seen her in videos. She's been very busy on a project, and it's taken a long time, and this is Rachel's project, now our project. Isn't she cute? Okay, oh, that's a bit on the corner there.
Yeah.
Perfect timing.